So good evening everyone, and welcome to this Medicine for Members event called Turn an End into a Beginning. My name is David Myers, and I hope you're going to enjoy the next 90 odd minutes. So you'll be hearing today about the challenges of getting people not just to sign up to the organ donor register, but also getting the families of patients who have signed up to the register to have the patient's wishes followed. So it's really important, if you have signed up to the register, that you make sure that you have fully discussed your decision with your next of kin and your family. So let me ask, how many of you here have actually signed up to the organ donor register? Fantastic. And how many of you people that have signed up have fully discussed it with the family? About the same amount? Brilliant. Well done. We'll see if we can persuade the others, the rest of you who didn't put your hand up. So our speakers tonight in running order are Richard Shube, who is the clinical lead organ donation, for organ donation at Barnet Hospital; Neil Banger, who is a consultant transplant and endocrine surgeon and National Organ Retrieval Service surgeon. He's not here at the moment, but we hope he is on his way here. He's been working all night and all most of the day doing his job. And we have a special guest, Kay Mason, who is about to celebrate the 10th anniversary of being the first altruistic kidney donor. We also, when those three parts have been completed, you'll have the opportunity to ask questions, and our panel will be those speakers, and we've also got a bonus of additional experts. Natalie Akenzua, who is a specialist nurse on organ donation; Alison Richardson, who is a live kidney donor coordinator. We've got a lead liver recipient transplant coordinator somewhere, I hope. I haven't seen her yet, but anyway. Craig Binch, who's another hero. He's a trauma and orthopedic senior matron, but he donated a kidney to a friend of his. And that is our panel. So, time for me to ask our first speaker to come to the stage, and this is Richard Shube. Thank you.
Right, so as David said, thank you, David. My name is Richard Shube. I'm one of the clinical leads for organ donation and the trust. I'm also the one of the intensive care consultants at Barnet Hospital. I think it's appropriate, and I'm glad that this is the kicking off of this evening's proceedings, because I'm going to be talking to you about organ donation. And I think it's important to remember that there can be no transplantation without organ donation. Organ donation is the start of that journey. And it's a difficult journey. It's sometimes an arduous journey. There are lots of challenges along the way, even to get to the point of organ donation, never mind transplantation. And really, that's what I'm going to talk to you about this evening. Let's see if we can, there we go. Some of you in the audience may have had the misfortune of hearing me speak last year this time. I know Judy's grinning in the background there. She's one of them. And I apologize for that. And last year I spoke about the history of organ donation and transplantation and some of the terminology that we use in the field. You'll be happy to know I've changed the talk this year, and I'll be speaking about something different. But I think it's important to go through a couple of terms right at the beginning, just so there's clarity in what we're talking about when we do talk about organ donation. So, firstly, there are two types of organ donation. There is living donation or live donation, and that might be, for example, where a mother donates a kidney to her son, or a donation between siblings, or possibly a donation even between people who are not related to each other at all. I'm not going to speak about living or live donation any further. The rest of my talk is going to be about deceased donation. And that's where the donor is dead and they donate the organs on to other people. Deceased donation makes up the majority of donation in this country. It makes up the significant majority of transplantation in the country. And that's what is my field of interest, that's what I do, and therefore that's what I'm going to speak about for the next 15 minutes or so. But even within donation, there are actually two types of deceased donation. And this is dependent, is predicated on the way that death is diagnosed in the donor. Okay? So there are two ways that we can diagnose death in an organ donor. Either it can be because their heart has stopped, and that we call that circulatory death. And if you donate after that, then it's called donation after circulatory death, or DCD donation. Alternatively, death can be diagnosed because the brain has died, or to be more particular, the brain stem has died. And through a variety of tests, we are able to establish that on a patient, and they are then declared dead. And if they go on to donate their organs after this mode of death, then it is called donation after brain stem death, or DBD donation. Now, you may think that this is really just semantics, the mode of death or the type of donation, but it does actually impact quite significantly, not only on donation, but indeed on transplantation as well. And I will come back to it a little later in the talk. Bit more background. This figure David has already alluded to, 3 patients die a day waiting on the transplant list. And I think it's important to look beyond the statistic that these are real people suffering, waiting, and unfortunately often dying on the transplant waiting list while they are waiting for these very, very precious organs. In the UK, in organ donation, seemingly we're actually getting better. If you look at this slide, and it does come out, thank goodness, this is a slightly busy graph, and I'll talk you through it. So I want you to first look at the blue bar charts at the bottom. And these are the number of deceased donors over the years from 2006 up to March of 2016. Sorry. And you can see that there has been, with the exception of 14-15, an incremental rise in deceased donation over that time period. And in turn, that's been translated into an incremental rise in the number of transplantation from these deceased donors. Most gratifying of all is the graph at the top. And that line there represents the transplant waiting list. And it has been a great source of satisfaction that that number has fallen, as you see, to under 6,500 by the end of financial year 15-16. It's a really cause for celebration, a pat on the back. We've done fairly well, really, don't you think? I think that's quite encouraging. But as always with these things, that doesn't tell the full story, because we can still do better. We can still make a big difference to those 6,500 who are still waiting. For them, that's not good enough yet, and it really shouldn't be good enough for any of us. We're lagging behind, and I'll show you why. In this graph here, it's dated back 2012, but in actual fact, the numbers are fairly static. And if you look, the red is the UK over there. And there are various other countries in the bottom, Croatia, Spain, France, etc., all through Europe. And there we are, we're in the middle. We're average. You're sort of okay, but not really that brilliant. And that's sort of really quite disappointing, because if you compare where we are with the leaders, Spain and Croatia, we could have twice as many organ donations that we have at the moment.
What are the units,
please? People per million, people per million population, PMP. So, you know, we're doing okay, but we could still undoubtedly do better. So what is it? Why is it that we struggle so much to take that next step, to push ourselves up, to get those extra donations. What is it about donation that means that it remains a relatively infrequent occurrence, almost rare sometimes? We throw tens of millions of pounds at organ donation. The budget for NHSBT is about 60 million odd a year. That's just for organ donation and transplantation. Hundreds of thousands of man hours are spent on it, and yet seemingly we just can't get there. For the rest of the talk, I'm going to talk you through this journey because I'm hoping it'll shed some light on why it's such a challenge to increase the number of donations. So, let's start off right at the beginning. The Office of National Statistics tell us that in the population of 65 million people that there are in the UK at the moment, roughly 500,000 people die every year. 1,500 people die in this country every single day. Now, if you look at that number, 500,000, you'd say 500,000 deaths a year, surely we can find 6,500 organs. From 500,000 people, surely. Where's it going wrong? Why can't we achieve it? Well, to start off with, in order for you to be a potential organ donor, you have to die on intensive care. Okay? Indeed, you have to be on life support at the time of your death in order to be even start the journey, even to be considered eligible to even start thinking about organ donation. You may not be necessarily in intensive care, but you'd have to be on life support in the A&E department, and in reality, the vast majority come from intensive care. Okay, well, then how many people of that 500,000 die under those circumstances, in other words, on life support in intensive care? Well, the answer is just over 7,000. So from 500,000, we've already plummeted by almost 99% down to just 7,200 patients who are in any way eligible. This is just the start of the journey, and already our pool has gone down to almost nothing. But that's not the end of it, because not only do these patients have to die on intensive care and on life support, but they have to have what we call controlled deaths. So what do I mean by a controlled death? Well, a controlled death is a death where we can predict when death is going to occur, at least with some degree of accuracy. And in reality, there are only two groups of the patients who are on intensive care who fulfill these criteria. The first group are the group of patients who are being treated on intensive care, and things are not going well, and the intensive care consultants who are looking after the patient think, this is futile. This is really not going anywhere. And they discuss it with the family, and with the agreement of the family, it's decided that we are going to withdraw intensive care support. We are going to turn the machine off, if you like. That is withdrawal of life-sustaining treatment. And what happens is you take the support away, and the patient's heart stops, and then they can go on to donate organs. Those are the DCD donors that I mentioned earlier, donation after circulatory death. That's the first group of controlled death. The second group are a group of patients on intensive care who are much less common, much rarer, and these are patients whose brains have died, where their brain stems have died. Okay, they may have had a catastrophic car accident or meningitis, something like that. Their brain has died, and that's the second group of patients whose death is controlled and therefore can go on to donate organs. But you will appreciate that our pool has shrunk again, because now not only is a patient on intensive care on life support, but they have to have a controlled death, and only some patients have that. But even that is not actually the end of the story, because even of this select group, the controlled deaths on intensive care, in order for them to be eligible for organ donation, they must have no absolute contraindication to organ donation. Okay? So yet again, this group is going to shrink further, because 20 to 40% of this very select group of controlled death patients on intensive care are going to have some form of contraindication, some reason that we can say, no, they cannot proceed with organ donation. What are the numbers like? Well, before we go to the numbers, what are the contraindications? Why couldn't you donate? What are the absolute? Well, it's a slightly busy slide. I don't expect you to read it. But they're the sorts of things you might have guessed. Someone with metastatic cancer, someone with active leukemia or lymphoma, someone who has got active tuberculosis or West Nile virus disease, or active, they've got AIDS, or those are the sorts of things you would appreciate would make them inappropriate to be an organ donor. And that's all very well and good, but of course our pool is shrinking even further. Here are the numbers that I alluded to. So last year there were 618 patients with brainstem death across the country and all in the intensive care units. 2,171 patients in whom the intensivists were going to withdraw the life support. Those were the controlled death group. But if we look down as the eligibility, only 62% of the DCD group were going to be eligible because of the contraindications, and slightly more of the DBD group. So yet again, this pool continues to shrink. So just to clarify and reiterate, the remaining pool of patients have to be patients who are dying in hospital, on intensive care, on life support, expected to have a controlled death, no contraindications to organ donation. You will appreciate we're talking about a pretty small pool of patients by this stage. And I'm afraid to say that is not the end of the story, because it's at this point that all we need is consent. Now, there is no word that strikes greater fear into the hearts of intensive care consultants or specialist nurses for organ donation, Natalie is smiling at this stage, than the word consent. All of you sitting in the audience this evening, or most of you certainly, you've come here, you're clearly interested in organ donation and transplantation. You think, can't be that difficult. Surely everyone thinks consent's a good idea. Surely families would agree to consent, having gotten to this very small pool of patients. And you would be right to think that. Certainly all the surveys of the general population all agree. 80 to 90% of everyone says, yep, transplantation's an excellent idea. 99% of people, unsurprisingly, would happily accept an organ should they need it. How difficult can consent be? Come on. Well, I'm afraid it's difficult. This is a slide where the UK is the leader, but I'm afraid it's the leader in a very bad way. This is refusal rates. And you can see that there are more refusals for organ donation in the UK than Lithuania, Greece, Latvia, Romania, Italy, Norway, etc., etc., etc. This slide, 42.5% of families, when we finally get to the point of asking them for permission to proceed with organ donation, say no. Now, it is true if their relative who is dying is known to have had a view that they wanted to donate organs, either because they've had that conversation or because they're on the organ donor register, then the consent rate does go up from 50, 60% up to 70, 80% possibly. And that's great, but we still have a problem with consent. Why? Why is consent so troublesome? Well, I think there's some things that we need to remember. Firstly, we are dealing with a shocked, grieving family at a very, very difficult time. For a lot of these families, particularly those who their relative is going to be a DBD donor, has suffered a catastrophic brain injury, a lot of those, it's come very suddenly. They were fit and healthy yesterday, and they had a terrible accident, and now they're dead. And that's a lot to take on board in addition to the loss, and then we come with this ever so difficult question to ask permission to make use of their organs for donation. You can see why that's a real challenge. So our specialist nurses in organ donation, there are a number of studies now which show that if a SNOD, a specialist nurse, is present at the time that we ask for consent, the consent rate goes up significantly. But as with everything in the NHS, there is a shortage of SNODs. We cannot always have a SNOD present, and that affects the consent rate. I've already alluded to this, that knowing the patient's wishes really is quite important, because it changes the consent rate enormously. we not infrequently have a conversation with the family and they say, well, we just don't know what our relative would want. We just don't know what our father, mother, son, brother would want, and therefore we have to say no. People are not having that conversation. Even people who are joining the register are not telling their loved ones that they've joined the register. Clearly, we're talking about issues, end-of-life issues, and so it should be no surprise that cultural and religious beliefs impact on a family's decision-making and the desire as to whether they say yes or no. And finally, there are time pressures. The reality is that the consent process and the donation process does take time. And for a shocked, grieving family, all they want to go do is go home and start the mourning process and be with their family and friends. The last thing they want to do is spend more time at the hospital. And not infrequently, families who are even really very pro-donation, even once they've given consent for donation, as the hours drift by while we wait for the process to actually take place, consent is withdrawn, just because they cannot take the stress of sitting there and waiting. Talking about clocks ticking, that's not the only clock that ticks. Even once we've gained consent, and you'll appreciate now that that's further depleted our very precious little pool of potential donors, another clock starts ticking. So firstly, there is the physiology of the patient. Patients in particular who have had brain death, who have, their brain has died, the rest of their body makes absolutely every effort to follow suit. The heart tries to stop, the lungs start to malfunction, the kidneys start to die. And we've got very powerful drugs and very powerful machines on the intensive care unit to try and hold back nature. But in reality, over the next few hours and possibly day or so, their body will shut down. So there is a clock ticking against what is going to be usable from an organ point of view. Bed pressures. We are very lucky in this trust that we have an adequate intensive care bed pool, that we do not generally come under pressure to give up the bed that the potential organ donor is being nursed in. But across the country, that's not the case. And there are a number of trusts, especially in winter, where the pressure on intensive care is such that they cannot support a potential organ donor. You can imagine that it provides an intensive care consultant with a huge ethical dilemma. If they have a patient who may be a potential donor on the intensive care unit and they get referred another patient who is critically ill, who has a reasonable chance of recovery, that poses a huge ethical problems as to what you do with the lack of bed. And finally, there are the family time constraints, and I've spoken about this already, how for families, as the time ticks, it gets more and more difficult to maintain consent for donation. Our pool is shrinking and shrinking, and even at this very late stage, we still lose potential donors. Why? Well, remember I explained to you the DCD donor process, whereby we take away intensive care support, we wait for the heart to stop, and then we proceed with organ donation. Well, sometimes we take away intensive care support and the heart keeps beating. The patient keeps breathing. Clearly, under those circumstances, we can't proceed with donation, and yet another donor is lost. And then even at the very, very late stage of the actual operation to remove organs for transplantation, there are times when the organs are examined, and although we thought they were going to be suitable for transplantation, they are not. If we look at the national averages, out of a potential number of organs, that might be 6 or 7 organs that could be used from a single donation. The national average is, 2 to 3 for DCD donors, 3 to 4 for DBD donors. So even at this very, the final line, we still lose organs to donation. So this slide really is a summary of what I've been talking about. You start at the top, 65 million of us living in the country, 500,000 deaths, half of those are in hospital. Those that die in intensive care on ventilators, down to 7,200. Eligibility of the donors down to 5,600. That's the controlled death bit of it. Donation requests, we don't go out to requests if there are absolute contraindications, so yet further depletion of the numbers. Consent, a big falling off again, the problems with consent, we're down to 2,000. We finally get down to just over 1,000 deceased donors a year, 1,300. On the plus side, that means 3,000, 3,500 transplantations, resulting in just under 4,000 organs actually being transplanted. In summary, hundreds of thousands of patients die every year. Of those, only a very tiny percentage would ever be potential organ donors, and an even smaller percentage of those will become that very exquisitely precious group of patients who are true organ donors. How can we improve that? Most of us feel the single biggest thing we can do is improve consent. If we maximize consent, we'll maximize donation. If we maximize donation, we'll maximize transplantation. And if we maximize transplantation, we'll minimize the suffering of those patients who are waiting on the transplant waiting list. Okay, thank you.
So we're going to hand over to Mr. Neil Panda.
So I'm one of the transplant surgeons here, and I'm going to give the surgeon's perspective. You've heard the intensive care consultant's perspective already. These are the things I'm going to talk about, the organ donor register, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about actually what happens when someone dies and donates their organs, and what our role is in that in surgeons, and then also something about the waiting list at the end. So we've already had a hands up as who in here is on the organ donor register. I hope everyone here knows what it means to be on the organ donor register. It's expressing your advanced wish that you would like to donate your organs if you're one of those small percentage of people that dies in a way where you can become an organ donor. But your next of kin still have to provide consent. And as the previous speaker said, we know that you're more likely, the family are more likely to provide consent if you are on the organ donor register than if you aren't. For those of you that are living in Wales, okay, sorry, I'll speak up a little bit. Is that better? Okay, a little tired. So, for those of you who live in Wales, there is in the last year or so, deemed consent has been brought in, or soft opt-in, which means you have to expressly say that you don't want to consent, but consent is still then required by next of kin, but it's just presumed that you don't have an objection unless you have actually made that objection. So it's sort of slightly turning it around, but it's still not a hard opt-in or opt-out awareness. The organ donor register, I think, is one of the reasons why we've had a lot more donations and transplants in the last few years, and you can see that really in the last 10 years or so, there's been a significant increase in the number of people on the ODR, but not as many as we would like. I think this slide is quite interesting. This looks at the different age groups for people that register, and you'd see that people in this, between the age of, for example, 16 and 40, form the highest percentage of those who sign up for the ODR. So I'm just going to talk a bit about the National Organ Retrieval Service. So I'm one of the surgeons here that participates in organ retrieval. NORS is the infrastructure through which organs are retrieved from deceased donors throughout the UK. There are teams of abdominal surgeons which are basically in the liver transplant centres, of which we are one. And also in the cardiothoracic transplantation centres, which cover various parts of the country. And all those surgeons have been trained in organ retrieval, and there is quality control in place. This gives you an idea of the different teams, which essentially divide the country up into zones. And your team is essentially on call for your area, and if a donor comes up in a hospital within your zone, you get called out to retrieve the organs there. If a donor comes up in a certain zone and that local team is already out, the next closest team goes, and then the next closest team after that, and so on and so on. So when you're very, very busy, occasionally you can be travelling all the way across the UK. As Richard said, time is very important because of donor instability and families withdrawing consent. So we don't like to leave people who donors where families have consented sitting on an intensive care unit for hours or days without the retrieval team coming. So if a retrieval team is free somewhere in the country, they will be transported up to that donor. When you get the call, you've got to be ready to go within an hour. And if you're on call for organ retrieval, that's all you're on call for. So this weekend, I was on call for organ retrieval. Our zone is sort of here, North London and the home counties. And the King's team were out, and I was called down to a donor on the south coast. So we travelled all the way down there. The donor down there also was eligible to donate their heart, and all the thoracic teams in England were out. So the thoracic team from Glasgow flew down to retrieve that donor's heart. So that's how it works. There's a lot of air miles involved. Okay, so this is the surgeon's experience. The phone rings, you'll have to get in. This is me here at the front, the lead surgeon. And you have an assistant, you have a scrub nurse, so we take our own scrub nurse from our own theatre's experience in dealing with retrieval and transplantation. We take our own driver, obviously, and we take someone called a perfusionist, who helps us with all the preservation solutions and actually with all the paperwork, because there's a lot of paperwork involved. As I said, we have to jump in the van within an hour, and then we get to the donor hospital. The first task which faces us, which is often surprisingly difficult, is finding the operating theatres. We then meet the SNOD and receive the handover. And we go through the checklist, and we liaise with the thoracic team if they're there, and we set up, and then often there is a bit of waiting around, for example, for availability of theatre, or for the thoracic team to turn up. Now you may be asking, what is a SNOD? If you put SNOD into Google, you get a picture of him, Robert Snodgrass, who I think he scored a hat-trick the weekend for Scotland. He's not at every donor hospital. A SNOD is at every donor hospital. They're a specialist nurse in organ donation, and that SNOD is Natalie, who's going to be speaking a bit later. And there, again, one of the reasons why the number of transplants and organ donations have gone up significantly in the last few years, there is essentially a SNOD for every trust, and one of their roles is to identify potential donors on the intensive care units. And there are a lot of donors that used to be missed, and one of the roles of the SNOD is to try and avoid those being missed. So I'll just talk a little bit about what it's like actually going out on a retrieval. There's many challenges. You're in a foreign hospital. Sometimes the staff there are incredibly friendly, particularly in the smaller hospitals. They're very nice and make tea and give you directions to the local restaurant after you finish or whatever else. But particularly in the big teaching hospitals, they don't want to know you're there. They just want to get on with their own cases, and they don't want you clogging at their theatre. And sometimes if you're waiting around a long time, you have to have a few hours sleep on an uncomfortable sofa. There's a lot of pressure. As Richard said, many organs can come from one donor. Now, I'm an abdominal retrieval surgeon, so I'll retrieve the liver, pancreas and kidneys only. It's often late at night, and you're aware of the significance of what you're doing, and there's a lot of people waiting for a phone call to say, yes, the liver looks healthy, you can go ahead with a transplant. I know the thoracic guys are under a lot of pressure as well, because the heart and the lungs, often they have to start the recipient operation before the heart has even arrived in the recipient hospital. So there's a lot of phone calls and a lot of dealing with queries. Now, we love our cardiothoracic colleagues, but the donor theatre can be a very busy place, and there's a little bit of jostling going on for position around the operating table, and we have to work very, very closely and communicate with each other. And I have to admit that that's something that's a lot better now than it used to be. Sometimes there'd be a lot of arguments and whatever else, but the thoracic teams I've been dealing with recently have been excellent and very professional. And then finally, I put this up because this is the thing that really bothers me sometimes. Often the donor's family have left a kind of toy or something that was very valuable to the donor, and they're often wheeled in to the operating theatre with that. And that's something that I put up really because it's something that we have to try and put out of our minds, because we're there to do a job. And that can obviously, you know, possibly be a little bit upsetting, particularly if it's quite a young donor. So all of this hard work that everyone's been doing, particularly the SNODs and the CLODs, the clinical leads for organ donation in all the different trusts, has led, I think you've seen the slide already, to a tremendous increase in the number of donors and the number of transplants in the last few years. And we've seen the waiting list fall dramatically. And that's due to the hard work of, this is our transplant theatre team. There's 25 kidney transplant centres in the UK, 7 liver transplant centres. There's teams like this all throughout the country. But obviously, most importantly, it's the donors and the family of the donors who give consent that are the most important thing in the process. So thank you very much for your attention.
So ladies and gentlemen, we're going to do something a little bit different and introduce you to Kay Mason, who I am in awe of for what she represents. She is about to celebrate the 10th anniversary of being a live kidney donor. She was the first kidney donor in the UK, and that operation happened here at the Royal Free. So we're going to... So, are you comfortable? So, Kay, let's start off spending a little bit of time just talking about your background in terms of your family and your working career.
Yes. Well, I live in Hertfordshire. I'm a retired palliative care nurse, and I'm divorced, and I have 4, obviously, adult children. As I was 63 when I donated my kidney, so you can work out how old I am now.
So when did you first think about being an altruistic kidney donor?
I first thought about it, and I can't remember any precipitating factor, in 2002, when I realised that unrelated people could donate. I had thought that only genetically similar people could donate. When I realised that, I thought, well, if unrelated people can donate, I could donate. And I didn't know, hadn't any experience of kidney disease, and I didn't know anybody who needed a kidney. And so I'll start at the top. And I wrote to Alan Milburn, who was the Secretary of State at the time, and he passed my letter on to the Department of Health. And they replied in a very dismissive way about the whole thought of that. There was apparently an act had come in 1989, which was called Human Organ Transplant, and a body called ULTRA, which stood for Unrelated Live Transplant Regulatory Authority, came as a result of that. And the whole thing was done a bit on the hoof because of the scandal of the Turkish young peasants who were brought and were being operated on in London by a very bad surgeon. And so they, I think, since then, looking up articles, particularly one in the Journal of Medical Ethics about ULTRA, I think really they weren't fit for purpose. And I exchanged about five letters with them, and they just were very dismissive and kept on about how there could be inducements and bribes and payment and things. And when I said, well, actually, you know, a stranger to a stranger, how could that be? That's much more likely to happen in families. They ignored me. And but they said there was a government consultative document coming out, particularly again because of the scandal, I think, at Alderhay over the retention of body parts. But the act, they were going to change the act to bring in transplantation. And they said that I could submit something to this document. And so I did, you know, saying particularly about, you know, how I felt it was a very easy way because, you know, you wouldn't have to feel guilty if you, in the way you might if you'd given to a relative and the organ had failed, or they might feel guilty because of your having done it and it failed. And then the Act changed in 2004 and was implemented in 2006. And by then I knew it was happening, so I had contacted Alison here and was first seen in July 2006. But all those years after.
It'd be true to say, really, that you had a real struggle. There was you thinking about and wanting to donate an organ, and the organisations that were apparently responsible for this were giving you no positive feedback. In fact, wasn't it the case that they said that there was no real public interest in this?
Absolutely, they said that. And I wrote to the National Kidney Federation as well, and they said that, which I hadn't been aware of, that there had been on one of the soap operas a scenario, and they had had 60 people contacting them saying they would like to give kidneys to strangers, and that had been dismissed.
That must have been EastEnders, wasn't it?
I'm not sure what it was, but
there was a
right,
a scene in that, yes. Yeah. So that government report was the report called Human Bodies and Human Choices, and that's what you contributed towards.
Yes.
And where did it go from there?
Well, then it was just a matter of waiting. I got a copy of it, and it was just a matter of waiting until. The Human Tissue Authority was being set up, and there was a doctor called Chris Rudge who I communicated with several times, and he said, just hang on and it's going to change and then it will be possible.
Yeah, Chris Rudge did my first fistula.
Oh, right.
So that was really quite a long period of time, being patient. During that time, did you ever feel like giving up?
No, I'm a bit of. I was once described as a terrier, and somebody recently called me challenging, and I wanted to do it, and I was going to do it.
All right. So now, after contacting the Royal Free, can we talk about what you experienced, what you had to go through on that pathway, which presumably Alison was guiding you through?
Well, in my case, it was very lengthy. And I understand now that it's much more streamlined. Yes, it definitely is. And I felt that I was investigated within an inch of my life. And some good things came out of it. One day, Dr. Harber told me that my cholesterol level was 8.2. And I was really indignant. And in fact, I was so cross about it. He had it done again, and it wasn't much lower. And I've been on simvastatin ever since, which was probably a good thing. A lot of the things were very frustrating. I had a lot of tests, which I'm sure everybody else does. One particular thing that was frustrating was that, and I think again that's changed now, at the time, although relatives and friends didn't have to have a psychiatric assessment, altruistic donors did. And it seemed to me that it was on the grounds that you must be mad to be doing it. And and in fact, somehow that was missed out on the on my journey. And right at the end, which and it was nearly a year later that it was discovered, the department here couldn't see me for many months. And I had the pleasure of going to the Priory to be seen, which was quite interesting. And I thought, gosh, you know, if I was paying for this, it'd be a lot of money. I don't know the result of that. I didn't ever see any report on that, but I think I must have convinced him that I wasn't mad.
Mm, we've come a, little way further over the years, because obviously we have a full psychology department.
Yes. And it's not essential now, I believe, Alison, is it? Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, they're checking me every month.
Yes, I had a CT scan for both my kidneys and then a test for individual kidneys. And I gather that anyway, the left kidney has a longer artery and is easier to transplant, but also they take your less good kidney. And that happened to be my left one. So that, and I had to have, oh, I think because of my high cholesterol, I had to have an exercise ECG. And I had to have a mammogram, and I, in fact, I had to have a breast biopsy after that, which was fine. But it was quite protracted.
And again, going through all of these tests over a period of a year, did you ever have second thoughts? Did you ever question what you were doing?
No, and I tell you particularly why. As I said, I hadn't had any experience of people with kidney disease. But going to the department and sitting and seeing people looking so unwell, I felt so privileged. And also reading, just reading the diet that they have to conform to, and you know, like boiling potatoes for 40 minutes or something, and not being able to eat baked potatoes, and all sorts of restrictions and gross fluid restrictions, I just felt that I had been extremely lucky, and some people are extremely unlucky.
Although currently, not to put off anyone that wanted to be a live kidney donor, the attitude these days from the renal dietitians has changed, because they realise that that patients shouldn't have to have an even worse experience, and so the attitude is more be conservative, and you're not really told these days boil the potatoes, boil all the goodness out of the vegetables, but have less of them and avoid those that will either be too high in phosphate or too high in potassium. But you know, similarly, when I first had dialysis, I had to put up with all of that as well, of the diet restrictions. But you know, it's very true that when you come into this hospital, however ill you might feel at any one time, you always see people that are more ill than yourself, and that makes you feel lucky to a certain extent. So you had the operation, and presumably you had thoughts when you woke up about what you'd experienced. And did any of these thoughts, were they changed in any way?
No. It was the first general anaesthetic I'd had, and I found it wonderful. I woke up feeling really on a high. I think maybe the morphine helped too. And early on, it was supposed to be a laparoscopic operation, and I had a little vessel that was not identified earlier, and that tore and I bled. And so I ended up with a more conventional incision, which was, I mean, I don't know how it would have been without it, but I was feeling pretty good when I woke up.
And after that operation, how long did it take before you got back to feeling normal?
I think it took, I was already retired, so obviously I didn't have to gauge it in terms of going back to work. But it was certainly 3 months. Although I know that some other people, especially who've had laparoscopic nephrectomies, are do far better than that.
Yeah, and now I know that you feel so confident about this that you don't come back regularly for your checkups, do you?
I don't, but I did come today.
Because really, most donors would, the renal team here would prefer it if patients came back every year so that they keep a good eye on them. But you haven't felt any negative issues with the operation,
no.
And you're back to normal fully.
I'm fine. Yes.
And it's nearly 10 years.
It is. Which is next July.
Which is absolutely incredible. What have you been doing over the last few years to, in any way, promote what you've done and live kidney donation?
Well, at the beginning, I was very anxious not to have any publicity, partly because I didn't want people to misconstrue why I had done it. And so I kept a very low profile, to the extent that I think it's recorded somewhere that the second donor was the first. And I maintained that until about 2011, when the charity Give a Kidney was formed. And Annabel Ferryman, who was a patient here, she gave a kidney to a friend here, I think probably in 2007 as well, and she works for the BMJ, and she formed this charity with some other people, and with a view to increasing the profile. And then I realised, particularly from hearing people speak, that most people still didn't know that it was possible to give to a stranger. And so lately I have been helping with publicity, and particularly for next year when it is 10 years, they're planning various things. I was just going to say that when I woke up and my daughter was visiting, and I think possibly Alison said, you know, she's the first donor, and Celia said to me, there's no advantage to being the first donor because nobody else will be mad enough to do it. But in July this year, the 500th person did it.
It's incredible, isn't it? And Kay is a piece of medical history for organ donation, for live organ donation, and for the Royal Free's part in that. So as I said at the beginning, I'm in awe of this lady. I know how important it will have been to the recipient. That was a patient up in Sheffield, and although you haven't had any contact, and it isn't necessary, but that person will have enormously benefited with extra years in their life from what Kay has done. So, please give her an enormous round of applause. We're going to have a question and answer, but I'll break the rule because if our expert panel want to move to the seats now, I'll just take a couple of quick questions here to fill in the gap. So you, sir.
Male and female.
Is there a difference?
Everyone's
kidney could be different in male kidneys. There's no set size for kidneys. I met someone yesterday who had 3 kidneys. There's no set size. If it's healthy, you can give it up. Mrs. Myers.
Have I felt any different? Not physically, but it gives me great pleasure to remember it. Most of the time I don't think about it, but I'm happy to think that I did it. No. And the remaining kidney grows and does the job of both of them.
Okay, well, if there's some more questions for Kay, we'll do it from over here. Can I ask you if you would like to ask your question number two? Can I ask Natalie to answer that? But before she does, can I also say that Natalie has been our specialist nurse on organ donation for 6 years, and she's leaving that post to another post within the hospital. But the hospital and all the people that she, all the patient families that she's dealt with, owe a great debt to someone who is a wonderful nurse, and our organ donation team are going to miss her. So I'd like to give you a round of applause for that first. And would you like to, Natalie, over here.
It's really a key question. Absolutely, our donor families are in the worst position possible. They can't get a loved one that's died in terms of race, and therefore they're going to die within the dream treatment. Our role as a specialist nurse is very much to meet that family beforehand and support them to ensure that they accept and understand what's going on before we discuss donation. Once donation then goes ahead, we give them the information and the time that they need. So as well as setting up the donation process, we will do things like when they want to spend time with their loved one, we'll do keepsakes for them to hand things, hair loss. They want to see their loved one after death, we'll support them to do that. I've done dance offices with the family, so we'll dress that donor and everything they want. So I have an 18-year-old who dressed in his Chelsea kit afterwards, a 7-year-old donor dressed in her Snow White costume. So we'll support them in that acute process. But also we'll provide a lot of ongoing support, so we'll write to them to tell them the initial outcome within about 3 weeks. Then we'll provide support during that time during the services that they need. We'll write to them on their anniversary and continue to give them the critical information if they want that over a number of years. So our time with that donor family is just at that point that we seek to set the donation, we'll meet with them beforehand, support them, ask that key question and support them afterwards. Obviously the support for the transplant side and the recipients is entirely down to my colleagues, so Laura Perrin as the transplant coordinator and people like Alison, so I'll hand you over to that part.
This is Moira Perrin, who is the lead liver coordinator.
So all recipients, you know, they go through quite a complex workup before they actually go onto the transplant waiting list. And then for liver patients, you know, there's no other option. We don't have dialysis like the renal patients. And some of the cardiac patients have mechanical devices that can keep them going to an organ becomes available. And unfortunately, we don't have those sorts of systems in liver transplantation. So we obviously, you know, there's some patients that, you know, can wait for a year or so, but some of the patients only have battles between 3 to 6 to 9 months to live. So, you know, it's cases like trying to get a suitable organ and working with both the snobbing and the more retrieval teams to actually facilitate that when an organ becomes available. Post-transplant, there are coordinates like myself that are like specialist nurses in liver transplantation who do a lot of work in supporting that family. And also part of that is also educating the recipient and also encouraging the recipient to, it's very grateful to the donor family for the decision to make, but also supporting them to help write a thank you letter, because, you know, we promote it as a gift of life, and obviously you should always say thank you to your gifts. And there's some national moves now to have a national leaflet for recipients to receive transplants, so they can actually write a thank you letter onto the donor family. But they always worry, they always have an anxious, because what they don't have to do is upset that donor family, so it's quite often some of the recipients don't write because they're actually fearful of upsetting a family that's done a lot of work and given them the best thing that they've ever had.
Okay, thank you very much.
At the moment, I don't think it's hugely about pressurising the government, and at the moment the Welsh project of opt-in, opt-out is still at a trial phase. And I think The jury is still out as to whether it's a good thing or bad. The natural inclination would be to think, well, opt-out must be better than opt-in. We'd surely get better numbers that way. But actually, if you look at the evidence, it's not as clear-cut as that. First thing to say is that the Welsh trial is what we call soft. Yes. In other words, there will still be the possibility for families to say no, even if the patient or the potential donor had not opted out. And I think most of us involved in organ donation feel that that's right. The last thing we need is a battle on the intensive care unit with us insisting on organ donation and fighting with a grieving family who are saying, no, that's not what this patient would want. So I don't think any of us feel that a hard opt-out is the right way to go. The second thing I would say is that the international evidence on opt-out, particularly soft opt-out, is mixed. It has worked in some countries, whereas others, such as Brazil, has been a complete failure. And in fact, organ donation plummeted when they brought in opt-out. So I think we need to go cautiously. It intuitively would be the right thing to do, and you know, everyone, oh yes, that must be right. But I think for those of us involved in organ donation, we're less convinced by it. And probably the greatest benefit that the Welsh project is going to have brought is that people are talking about organ donation. That's probably more important than anything else. No, this was organ. This was solid organ donation alone.
Surprised what the application to donation is. It is 85, but we have gone over that. If there is good organ function, we'll ring our colleagues in the transplant center and say, would you consider these organs? I think if you actually get to that age, I'm not too high, but then you're probably doing pretty well. So there's age-specific criteria. So for the cardiothoracic organs, as you say, your lungs, you'd be too old. It depends what type of donor you are, as Richard said, in terms of the DVDs and DCD donors. So heart and lung donation is a younger age limit, but things like kidneys, certainly we will have renal donors that are in their 80s. Absolutely. So we very much say to people, don't worry what age you are, sign up on the register. It's fantastic that you signed up to me if you're going to medical science. For a lot of people, that's a key question just to clarify. If you do donate your body to science, you can't donate your organs as well. However, you can certainly sign up for both, because often, as we know from Richard's speak, that actually it's only 1% of the population dying away that they're able to donate the organs, so you can certainly then donate your body to science.
Thank you.
The answer is we're not entirely sure. Spain has been the leader for quite a long time. And what we have been doing over the past, say, 6-7 years, somewhere around there, is really based very much on the Spanish experience. In Spain, probably most of the success is down to structure, in that they had organ donation committees, clinical specialists in organ donation, and everything that goes with it long before we did. They led in this. And that probably explains most of their success. And really the rest of the world is trying to catch up with them. The thing about organ donation is it almost feeds on itself. So with the success in Spain, as organ donation climbed and climbed and climbed, it started to become part of the dying process, at least for those very small minority of patients who could go on to donate. And so, whereas in this country, I think a lot of families are still surprised when you talk to them. In Spain, it was, well, that's just part of the dying process, and would be surprised if they weren't approached. And so, hopefully, again, as we start to build momentum, and as Neil pointed out, we are improving, we are getting better. Then again, as the success stories start to rise up in the public consciousness, maybe it'll become a normal part of the process here as well. Look, these conversations are clearly extremely difficult. And I think most of us who do have these conversations with families, the first thing to say is it's absolutely crucial that
In fact, you don't have one conversation, you have two. Because the first conversation you have with the family is that their loved one has died or is going to die. And that is that conversation. An organ donation does not form any part of that conversation because to some degree it's a completely separate issue. And we would not want ever those two issues to be confused in the relative's mind. So we would normally have a conversation with the family to say that their loved one has died in the case of brain death, or is going to die in the case where we are going to withdraw intensive care support. And it's my practice normally to then leave at that point and allow time for that to sink in with the family, because clearly it's shocking news, it's desperately difficult news to hear, they need time. And then only significantly later will either I or Natalie or one of Natalie's colleagues go in to revisit the family. And at that stage, and possibly not even that stage, but even after that again, would the possibility of organ donation be raised with them. Though it really is quite important that those two elements are separated out. The second part of your question about different family members, again, conflict is something that is of no benefit to anyone. And while there clearly is a hierarchy as far as who can consent to donation for their loved one, we wouldn't proceed with organ donation if there was disagreement within the family. So it's, as you would expect, you often speak to not just one person, but you're speaking to maybe a spouse and three or four children and maybe grandchildren or parents or whatever the case may be. And sometimes there's a disagreement. Sometimes half the family says yes and half the family says no. And that's clearly very difficult, and the different techniques we use to try and explore why maybe some of the family are against organ donation. But at the end of the day, if there is conflict, if there is disagreement, then we wouldn't proceed with organ donation, because we feel that in the longer term we're doing a disservice to that family.
Yes, that's a very good question, and it would solve our problems. Animal organs or xenotransplantation is something that people have been searching for a long time, and it's still, unfortunately, in the lab. There's a lot of immunological barriers which we haven't been able to overcome. So that's still very much a research thing, and I'm not sure if we're going to see that, you know, for a few decades. And we don't know for sure if it will be possible. In terms of growing human organs from human stem cells, that's also very experimental. I think it's possible in our lifetimes we might see that. But again, I think that's still a decade or two away. But that might be the answer in a sort of medium term for short course. Okay, so in terms of prioritization for liver and heart, it's super urgent. So if there's someone who desperately needs one of those organs who's going to die in a very, very short period of time, the first compatible organ that comes up in the country for them will go to that person, no matter where it is in the country. For all the other organs and heart and liver patients where it's not super urgent, then there's a scoring system. And waiting time is one of the things that contributes to that scoring system, but there's lots of other things in terms of compatibility and whatever else. So it's prioritised in an objective manner by a scoring system for most of the organs, although I think for some of the thoracic organs, it's done on a centre-by-centre basis, but certainly kidneys, and it's going to be liver and health. Is that?
It's coming.
Yeah, liver's going to national allocation soon, pancreases. I think the thoracic organs is still centre by centre, but I think that's going to go national as well. So that's an objective measure. And so the second question was...
Can't preserve any of the organs?
Yeah, so they have all got a limited lifespan, and at present, really everything has to be transplanted within 24 hours approximately, although the certain organs is less than 12 hours. We have got some new technologies which can keep them going a little bit longer than that. But at the minute, no, you can't stick them in the deep freeze and then thaw them out and then use them a week later, unfortunately.
Actually, it isn't a question. I've received 2 islet cell transplants in this hospital in the year 1415. And had I seen Richard's presentation before I had the transplant, I would never have expected to receive them, never mind 2. And I would just really like to thank this hospital because the work is outstanding. And the islet cells, the second transplant, was a success, and my life has changed. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
It is certainly a key issue in terms of a large proportion of patients on the transplant waiting list will come from Black, Asian, minority ethnic groups because they have a greater incidence of diseases that will cause even problems. And unfortunately, on the reverse side, there is a much less percentage of patients or people from those backgrounds and communities that are on the organ donor register. So a huge amount of work is ongoing at the moment to increase discussions about donation, consent about donation within those community areas. So a lot of outreach work, a lot of work within religious communities, for example, about people understanding that. And that actually the difference is that it doesn't matter the ethnicity of a donor to a recipient, however, it's going to be a much better match if you have a similar ethnicity. So that you need people from all ethnic groups and ethnic backgrounds to sign up on the organ donor register. So it sounds a little bit airfaring that we're doing a lot of work, but even just promoting sort of donation and the idea of transplantation within those communities, and that does sit within people's cultural norms, within people's religious beliefs, that there is no cultural, ethnic or religious group that will completely rule out either donation or transplantation. We've had donor families and recipients from all walks of life, so pretty much encouraging the messages, but we see a lot of the stuff that NHS Blood and Transplant have done in Organ Donation Week this week. It really is about increasing the BAE consent rates and on the organ donor register. In terms of the other side, the transplanting side,
I think one thing that we could say is that if you're really interested in playing with heart in promotion, then afterwards give us your details and we'll see if we can find a way. Because really, we need more volunteers that have had the experiences and want to be better informed. And believe me, this whole area of organ donation, I've been involved with kidney patients for over 15 years. When I first started going through the material, there were things there that I didn't know. So it's a big area, but there's lots of materials to be able to learn from. So we're very happy for whoever wants to volunteer to try and carry out that role. Is that okay? Are you all right with that answer? Yeah? All right. Gerald, I know you're a superb speaker, but can I ask you, keep the question simple, because it may be the last. Or if you don't keep it simple, it will be your last question.
Yes, you can. And it's a complicated choice based on the person. You can have what's called a simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant, or SPK, from a deceased donor, which is a very big operation. But it deals with both problems at the same time. The alternative is, particularly if you have a living donor, you can have a living kidney donor transplant first and then have what's called PALK, pancreas after living kidney, which is a slightly smaller operation because at the time of having that operation, you don't have kidney failure anymore because you've got to work in kidney transplant. So it depends on if you have a live donor and it depends on various things like your blood group and how long you would wait for a deceased donor, kidney, pancreas, and it depends on how severe your diabetes is. So there's just so many things. So there isn't really a general answer more than what I've just said. It would depend very much on your consultation with your physician.
Thank you. Great.
Okay, well, I think we're going to have to pack up now. So I hope you enjoyed it.